which we normally call consciousness. What is the difference between sleep and waking state? That is what is called light in its true sense. The present light, what we see, is called the optic light, which is a part of the objective light. According to the ancient thinkers, light is also of four stages. The fourth is the objective stage, and there are seven layers in the objective light. The eighth called the synthetic ray of light is what we call the optic light. That is how the ancient thinker gave us. Once again I'll repeat. Light exists as consciousness in four levels. And the fourth is what we can call the objective light. When it is objectivized or externalized from the sun as the sun's ray, it gives birth to the worlds, that is the creation, the planets, etc. And it contains seven layers. And a synthetic layer, eighth one. And this eighth one, the synthetic layer, is what we call the optic light, which contains the seven colors of this spectroscopy and the eight. And there is one difference between the ancient understanding and the modern understanding of the spectroscopy also. We understand that the white ray is the synthetic ray. That is the eighth ray, which includes the seven. According to them, there are eight rays. That is the white on one side and the blue on the other side of perception. Blue and white are interchangeable according to them. That is, in a stage of perception, the white ray contains all the other seven rays. In another stage of perception, the blue ray contains all the other seven rays, including the white. See, when you are in the stage of the perception of the blue ray, you perceive all the other seven, including the white ray, as one of the seven. But if you are looking from this side, that is, you are in a stage of the perception of the white ray, you will see all the other seven, including the blue, as the components of the white. So the white and the blue are considered as interchangeable. Just this is only a hint. In fact, it has quite a branch of science which requires some volumes or some month course to understand in the Vedic texts. There is a branch of text for each of these rays. For example, for the red ray, there is a section called Aruna. Aruna means the red ray. All the mantras and the hymns there, they are named the Aruna section. Like that, every color has its own literature in the scriptures, which we can someday study for ourselves. For the present, this is enough. And the light that exists in four stages has the fourth stage only giving out what we call the objectivity or the voids. That's why what we call all these beings, all these voids, is only one fourth. That means when you say all this, it is objectivity. That is, you are able to perceive it away from yourself. Such a stage is only one fourth. And the other three fourths, they exist in the light, which can be perceived by oneself through meditation, because it's not different from himself. It never exists different from himself. You have to know it as your own consciousness. So, you have to understand the three-fourths as the light. That is, the three layers of self-consciousness. It exists in you like that, because creation exists like that in the cosmic mind of the Creator. And you are part of that creation. Therefore, the same thing exists in you also. Since we are part of the same creation, we are existing in the same thing, we too have all these levels in us, levels of perception. We have the one-fourth, which we call the objectivity or the tangible universe. And it is one-fourth. And we have our three-fourths in ourselves. For example, we have the four stages of utterance of our word, which I'll repeat once again. The other day I was speaking of it. Four stages of utterance of the word. Whatever we speak it in four stages, and the fourth stage comes out. I tell you, I say a sentence, this is a watch. We call that sentence vocal English sentence. That is vocal language sentence. The Englishman speaks in English, the Frenchman speaks in French. Vocal language sentence. Vocal language sentence. Before I utter, this is a watch, I should utter it in my mind, otherwise I can't utter it out. Do you accept? Therefore, before this, there is the other sentence, mental language sentence. I should utter it in English, this is a watch, in my mind, before I utter it out. So there is the mental language sentence. And before I utter to myself the mental language sentence, I should utter it to myself without any language. That can be called the thought sentence. That is mental sentence or mental thought sentence, you can call it. everyone utters it commonly, but everyone translates it into his or her own language mentally and then utters it out in the third stage. At first we are uttering the same language, that is thought language, and then each one of us translate it into our own language in mind, and then we utter it out in the third stage. As you trace the utterance of every word, every sentence you utter, it is inevitable that your word should pass through all these three stages. And before this, what was there? It is called the stimulation or the spur to utter. You should feel that you should utter the sentence. The stimulation is the utterer as word, because the sentence you want to utter is not yet different from yourself. It exists with you as your own idea to utter. That means it exists with you as yourself. A little bit, not difficult, but unfamiliar. If you think of the wave in the ocean, is the wave different from the ocean? It is different because it hits you if you are not careful. But it is not different because there is nothing different from the ocean in it. The difference is only a direction of force locally applied. That's all. The force of the ocean differentiates itself as a wave from the ocean, whereas the wave is in no way different from the ocean. Do you follow? In such a way, the word you are going to utter is in no way different from yourself at that stage. It is going to emerge as a wave from yourself. That is called the fourth stage of utterance. And every word or sentence you utter passes through these four stages whether you notice it or not. If you notice it, it is called meditation. If you do not notice and utter whatever you want, it needs medication. So, these are the four stages of utterance. When we count them from our side, that is objectivity. But they start from the other side and they come to us. The other is reversed, because we are trying to learn them. We are approaching the temple from this side, but the temple exists on that side and we have to start from the other side. This should be the first stage of utterance, when it is not differentiated from the utterer. And then this should be the second stage, this should be the third stage, and this should be the fourth stage. So, the objective sentence and its meaning you utter, it is one-fourth of the total word. and the remaining 3/4 exists in you as the world. But if, because it is undergoing the 3 transformations, because before it comes out as the objective world. That is what this means. In the same Rig Veda, there is another passage called the hymn to the goddess of the word and utterance. That is called Saraswati hymn. We find the same thing described there. They say the hymn runs like this. Chatvari va padani. That is, 4 are the stages of the word you utter. Tani vidur brahmana ye manishinaha. Those who know all the 4 are called the followers of Brahma, the meditators of Brahma, and they are called the wise ones. Those who know all the 4. Guha trini nihita. 3 are concealed in the cave and they exist in the cave of yourself. Nengayanti. They never come out. Turiyam vacho manushya vadanti. The 4th one comes out and it says, you can utter me. And the people utter it. That is how the verse from the hymn of Vak or the goddess of speech is described. Identically the same thing. So this is the 4 stages of utterance of your own sentence. Speech. The 4 stages are technically called in the Vedic language. The first one is called para, that is the highest. That is the utterer as the word. The first stage is called paravak or utterer as word. In the second stage, it is called pasyanti, that is, word as seen by the utterer. The third stage, madhyama, that is, the intermediary stage between the word and the utterer. Intermediary stage between the word and the utterer. 4. Vaikari. This word as form. Previously it was within you. There's no form. When you utter it out, that this is a check piece, there is a form to it. A sentence form, a word form, a sound form, and a form of meaning, concept, transmission, and reception. It is the process of objectivity. We transmit and the other fellow receives it as sound, translates it as thought. Again, the same process is reversed in the listener. Pardon? Different powers operate while this action is going on. So, these are called the 4 stages of utterance of the word. And now, you are expected to apply these 4 stages to the Creator. And He utters the whole universe through these 4 stages. First, He gets the idea that He should create. Then he gets the concept of creation according to his recollection of the previous universe. And then he translates it into his own language, what we call Rik. His own language is called Rik. It is a peculiar word. Rik means it is the stage of perception from which the perception of sound and the perception of light branch off. Before they branch off, the perception is called Rik. We have two powers expressing as two sense organs. One, the organ for the light, and the other, the organ for the sound. But before they differentiate, they function only as one inside. That is called the level of Rik. So, the Creator brings it to the stage of his Rik, that is sound and light. Then light comes down as his awakening in the form of the so many living beings. Sound comes down as what we understand now as space, the reservoir of sound principles. It is another branch which we have to study someday in the scripture. Space is called the lake of sound principle in the Vedas. And consciousness is called the light awakened in us. So, before they are separate, they are one with the Creator in the third stage. So, he creates according to Rik. Because this is explained, it is called Rig Veda. Because the main thing that is explained in Rig Veda is light and sound. Especially Rig Veda is characterized by its own ingenious explanation of the gateway between subjectivity and objectivity. In fact, there are a group of people who worked out this branch in Rig Veda, and they called themselves Aitareyas. That means those who worked out the theory of objectivity. Those group of people called themselves Aitareya. That means, Itara means in Sanskrit objectivity, something different from ourselves. These people specialized in the subject objectivity, and they tried to explain what objectivity is and how it takes place, etc. It is a bit difficult. Let us not enter into it too much for the present. Next year we can enter a little more into it, a little more deeper into it, when you get familiarized with the other things. In fact, it is not difficult, but it is a bit unfamiliar to the modern centuries. That's all. The more we get familiar, we find it easy. It's not difficult to understand these things. So the creator feels that he should create. Immediately the idea of creation separates from himself. And then he finds it in the second stage. That is the concept. The whole creation is his concept. And then he sees it in the stage of Rik. That is space and time. That is sound and light. And then it comes out as creation. He utters it out. The fourth stage is the creation uttered out. The difference between our utterance of the word and his utterance of creation is, he enters his own utterance and he exists in it. He never exists separately, whereas we exist separately even after we utter our word. Our word escapes into air, whereas he enters into his word and lives in it as creation. That is how the concept goes. Okay? Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah.
In the third stage.
No, this is Rik.
Only that. What is the characteristic of the second stage?
The second stage, as a concept.
Between the other as word and Rik.
Rik is grosser than this stage. This, here, the Rik exists only as a concept. Here, it exists as differentiation. There is no differentiation here.
How do we get from concept to Rik?
It is through a stage which is equivalent to what we call awakening from sleep. You can compare it like that. Sure, sure. Stage 1 and 2 are beyond time and space, and even a part of concept, because just concept is forming. It's not even mental. Remember your state of mind the moment you wake up from sleep, just the first moment. Do you have an idea of your environment? But you have, but it's not an idea. It is a previous stage. Do you remember where you slept? You remember, but not mentally. That is the stage. And the next moment you will come to the mental stage and you will understand that you are in Geneva for the past 2 days. You are sleeping there and there is Ruth and all these people. Like this. So we come into names, shapes, colors, etc. and the fourth stage. And the third stage, and then we work in the fourth stage. So the third stage is the stage of concept. That is a mental comprehension of what we had in the second stage. And the fourth stage is where we are totally different from others. It is objectivity. I cannot be yourself and you cannot be myself in the fourth stage. So, for this reason, the creator is described as four-faced Purusha. You know, in the Indian scriptures, the creator is described as four-faced. He is having the four stages as his four faces. And his word starts as the spur or stimulation. And the first differentiation of his word from himself is called the origin of power from consciousness. Since then only you will find energies working. Before that there was only the owner sleeping without any energy. Then the spark starts. There is the energy separated from the owner of the energy. Yes, it was in the background, and the background is himself. There was only one fellow. The energy goes into the background and leaves one with the background. And there is only one fellow, no energy and power, no two fellows. Just as your thought was one with you, and you were there only as yourself and not as yourself and thought in the beginning. Then immediately thought comes to you. Then there are two, yourself and thought. Like that the energy was with you. Pardon?
What is the body?
Yes, it is. What is called? Awakening of the one fellow into a second thing. That much only can be expressed now.
Can we compare this?
Yes.
With the
yes, exactly. Here starts the cosmic. Cosmic plane, then cosmic paranirvanic, cosmic nirvanic, and cosmic mahaparanirvanic is the original. Cosmic paranirvanic is a subdivision. Cosmic nirvanic is the next subdivision. Cosmic buddhic is the next. Cosmic mental is this one. Yes, this one. Yes. And this is the seventh subplane of the seven planes. The total, the one-fourth, which we call objectivity, is the seventh subplane of the seven main planes of existence. So, all the other six subplanes are included in this. And
in this fourth or in one?
In this only.
Okay.
And the remaining six main planes are included in these two. For example, the seven subplanes are included in these two.
Seven
subplanes are included in the in the third and fourth stages. And then there are six more main planes, is it not? Six more planes. Five planes are included in the second stage. One. Only one main plane, it is subplanes, is included in the first. Yes, yes. But it is better to understand the two terminologies differently for about 1 year and then go through certain passages in the secret doctrine and then come to the Tibetan. That is how I have done, and let us do it. That's how my father instructed me. That's why I had a clear-cut idea of the two different types of division, because the Tibetan follows the division given by the ancient Buddhistic school, which is the most original of all the presently existing schools. You see, because he has given it only in that way, in the secret doctrine, therefore he continued the same way through Alice Bailey also. But luckily, he has given all the pre-Buddhistic methods of differentiation also in the secret doctrine, and we find good commentaries of all these methods of differentiation in the secret doctrine. Therefore, we study the Purusha Sukta for the present, and then we get familiarized. The next year I will present to you the passages from the Purusha Sukta concerns. You can get yourself familiar with the explanations of the secret doctrine, and then the Tibetans, that is Alice J. Bailey's work. Like that. So here, all the verse teaches us that 1/4 is this universe. This whole creation comprises 1/4. And he has the remaining in himself as the other 3/4. That is what he says. Yeah. Yes. No. The stimulation is called power. Power. Power separate, differentiating from?
Power. Okay.
Power differentiating from consciousness. In the first stage, the spur comes to him to create. That means the creator feels, I create. That is called the origin of power or the differentiation of power from consciousness. Sure. Because the seven rays is the background of everything. After working out the details, we will understand the fitness of everything in the theory of the seven rays. Pardon? No, in all the four phases, from here, power works. In the first, it is called para.
Oh, okay.
These are the names. She is called. Here the power is compared with the female principle, whereas the consciousness is compared with the male principle. Always in the ancient scriptures, power is female and consciousness is male. That's good. I wish you to be powerful. So these are the, it is said that the wife of Saraswati, the wife of Brahma is called Saraswati. The creator is called Brahma the four-faced. The word Brahma means self-expansion. Para pasyanti madhyama vaikari. Okay? These are the four stages. And Brahma the creator is described as four-faced. The word Brahma means self-expansion. The four are the four different forms of the same Shakti. And then Brahma has now his wife Saraswati. The word Saraswati means a flow, a river. That means transference, to transfer and to transmit. That is what the word etymologically means. Yes, because they are expected to explain these things.
Brahma?
Pardon?
Why is the wife of Brahma?
Because it is described that she is born from him, but he chased her and he followed her, because energy flows and then consciousness flows through energy. Because first, energy flows and then thought flows in the line of energy. Yes. And she is said to reside in his four faces. She exists in his four faces. That is how it is described.
But isn't it always a fellow with six faces?
No, he is not a creator. After creation, there are many faced fellows. So it is mentioned here that all this creation is one-fourth of himself. The other three-fourths exist in his light. Previously, it was described that he multiplies by 10 digits. Now, you apply the two formula together. What happens? You have the four stages, then added numerically the 10 stages.